National Institute of Advanced Studies. My PhD was in molecular biology, but subsequently I changed fields and started working in animal ecology, behavior, conservation, genetics. I am a professional monkey watcher. I think that's enough for the introduction. But I've also been interested in teaching, in education, in philosophy of biology, but we can talk about that later. So in today's talk, I first wanted to remember one particular individual for whom I'm here today, and it's only suitable that on Foundation Day I remember him, and that is Professor Rajaramanna. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here today, and I owe him an enormous debt of gratitude for having shaped my life in many ways. I will also start off with a quote from Dr. Ramana, which I've repeated ad nauseum, and I'm sure many of you have heard it several times, but I think it's such a lovely story. So we were celebrating his 75th birthday, and there was a little photograph, so photographs were being taken, and he was in the middle. And at that time, my PhD student, M.D. Madhusudan, who happens to be the first student directly from the NIAS PhD program who graduated, and he was there. And he called Madhu and he said, "Come, you stand on my side, on one side, because the oldest and the youngest of the institute should be together today." And then he suddenly saw me and he said, "Now you come and stand on the other side, because you represent all the other species." So I think I represent all the other species in this seminar as well. I have of course taken the liberty of not following strictly what Baldevji had asked me to do. I will not speak of only agriculture. I think I've increased the scope to include other aspects in which there is conflict between humans and wildlife. But also, he asked me to speak on wildlife, but I'm condensing it to macaques, which is what I know very well. But I also have this very insidious plan of talking a bit about my work, which is why I wanted to bring it down to macaques. Right. Now, so the wars with primates, between primates, humans and non-humans, have been on for a long time, and I'll write down here briefly what are the kinds of conflicts that primates typically face with humans. First, of course, is crop raiding, retaliatory killing, and the Munzala is a species which you see here. It's a species that we reported for the first time, and we now find that there is quite a bit of conflict with it in some parts of Arunachal Pradesh. There is also extensive hunting for food and sport, particularly in northeastern India. There are killings of lorises for their so-called medicinal value. There's excessive loss of rainforest habitats for timber and other extractive use, which is harming, therefore, the populations of these species. There is conflict over crop and kitchen raiding in northern and southern India with the two species, Rhesus macaques in north, bonnet macaques in the south. And of course, there is decline of bonnet macaques due to a very interesting phenomenon, which I will talk about briefly in my talk, which is that of tourism, where apparently a benevolent act of humans proves to be extremely detrimental to the species that we study. Of course, non-human primates have had a long history of association with us, and there is therefore this very strong debate about where they actually stand and we actually stand vis-a-vis this conflict, the relationship that we have with them, which is increasingly becoming fraught with a lot of difficulties on the part of both species. I would also like to say here that in line with what Dr. Rajaramanna exhorted me the first time we met, he said, "I will give you a job in NIAS on one condition, that you continue to work with wildlife, with the other species." And that's what I'm going to do. So my talk will be biased a bit towards trying to understand how the non-human species fares in this conflict. And so I think there are a lot of people thinking about people, but there are relatively fewer people thinking about the non-people. So what are the causes of, I just wanted to also show you that this is a wonderful icon from a temple in Lalitpur in Nepal. I don't even know whether it has survived the earthquake, where there's a rhesus macaque who's holding a jackfruit and in chains, and which clearly is sort of really summarizes beautifully the problem of crop raiding by macaques and the retaliation that they subsequently face, understandably, of course. Right, so what are the causes of this conflict? First, of course, there is rapid urbanization, recruitment of crop fields, encroachment of forests, establishment of monocultures, which therefore have led to infiltration of non-human species from their natural habitats into people's areas. There's also provisioning of primates due to religion, tourism. They have easy accessibility to garbage dumps. There's extensive crop and kitchen raiding by particular macaque species, troops, and individuals. And I've highlighted species, troops, and individuals because what we have not recognized also is there's a tremendous amount of variability. And it's always, sometimes we say, oh, bonnet macaques raid or elephants raid crop fields. But what our studies are now showing is that sometimes these may remain restricted to certain groups or certain individuals. And therefore, a general battle against them may not always be effective. There is aggression by both humans and macaques towards each other, leading to attacks and often serious human injury. And of course, one problem that we've been facing, which is that of unplanned translocation of primate groups to other areas closer to human habitation. It's really, the way the translocation works is a wonderful representative of our social hierarchy. So cities transport their monkeys to villages, villages transport it to the smaller hamlets, the Brahmin communities will transfer it to the non-Brahmin communities, and it's a wonderful way you can analyze social hierarchies by looking at how these monkeys are transported from one place to another. There is occasional transmission of zoonotic diseases. So these are often when there are certain factors which can transmit the disease between the non-human species and the human species. A good example of this is the Kaisanur forest disease in Shimoga, where there's a tick which carries the virus between bonnet macaques and humans, and every year there are about 5 or 6 deaths. It has remained restricted to particular areas, but it's nevertheless an important cause of conflict between the species. Now, the reason why agriculture has led to this kind of conflict is because, of course, we have 60% of our land under agriculture with about maybe less than 20% on the forest cover today, and clearly, therefore, for most species, agricultural fields are a good food source. It's as simple as that. You have a choice between feeding on in the forest, and suddenly you have around you extremely rich crops, which are nutritionally rich, which are easy to access, easy to harvest. Sometimes individuals must make a choice of coming out, even without other driving factors. And this is something we need to recognize, and it has been recognized for other species as well. Now, I will quickly go through some important issues. One case study, one point that I think I must make is that there is very little data that is available. We talk of the problem all the time, but there has been very little documentation of the problem. And I think our group, particularly Sindhu is here, has been, we've trying to now start projects which are trying to actually evaluate the extent of conflict, both from the perspective of the people as well as from the perspective of the non-human species, to try and understand and get figures for what is happening. Now, this is some old data. This is Himachal Pradesh, which has been one of the states which has been really plagued by rhesus macaque, crop raiding by rhesus macaques. And this is, it summarizes Himachal Pradesh, where there is 25% of forest cover, cultivated land is about 12%, the population density of humans is about 92 per kilometer square. But if you look at now the data, and this is slightly older data, if you look at the number of rhesus macaque troops, you have 5,700 troops with about 2,76,000 individuals, which is huge, right? And if you look at the extent of cultivated land and forest land, it's clearly a magnet for most of these macaques. And in fact, if you look at the rural and urban areas of Himachal Pradesh, not going into the forests, you have about close to 1,500 troops with 70,000 individuals, which live with people. They don't, these are not forest troops. Right. So, if you look at now the density of rhesus macaques, you find that in the forested areas, you have about 15 individuals per kilometer square, whereas even in urban and rural areas, you have about 5, which is 1/3 of what exists in the forest. And therefore, clearly, this is, there's bound to be conflict. And the extent to which this has gone is one estimate by the Kheti Bachao Sangharsh Samiti in 2006 was that approximately 53% of all crop damage could be attributed to rhesus macaques, 23% to wild pigs. However, I must add a note here that our findings seem to indicate that perhaps rats or rodents, wild pigs have slightly been underestimated. Extent of damage they do has been underestimated because they are nocturnal. The rhesus macaque is diurnal, so people clearly see the macaque and therefore it becomes enemy number one. However, the loss to pigs and rodents can often exceed perhaps those of macaques, but that's a moot point. Secondly, the monetary loss that was estimated, and again this is just one estimate that we have in 2006, is that of about 75 crores to horticulture and 100 crores to agriculture during a three-year period between 2003 to 2006. What this also has implications for is actually something that perhaps social scientists need to look at, which is there are very well documented instances but not put down so much in writing of villages and agricultural lands which are abandoned. In fact, some representatives of the Samiti, when they met me, told me that there were families who were unwilling to give their daughters in marriage to villages which had rhesus macaques simply because they said they didn't want their daughters to starve. So clearly this is a problem of, it's an enormous problem, and we've done nothing about it. Not only have we tried not to understand it fully, but we've had knee-jerk reactions. And the problem, of course, gets compounded by the fact that people have also a very ambivalent attitude towards, let's say, rhesus macaques, which is also a religious item. In fact, the Himachal Pradesh Forest Department and the government allowed, about 2 or 3 years ago, gave rights to the people to shoot down monkeys, simply because they were unable to handle the problem. It turns out, ultimately, that over the last 2-3 years, the number of monkeys that have been killed are very, very few. And that's primarily because the people would tell you, if you interview them, that you know, they are also God's creatures. They need to live as well. Of course, we have to guard ourselves, but they need to survive as well. This attitude is remarkable. I think it's very, very, I would say Indian, not even Oriental, because I think in many areas, this recognition of the brotherhood of species is what marks us very differently from perhaps many other cultures, but we can take that during the discussion. Now, the other species, the bonnet macaque and the lion-tailed macaques, particularly in southern India, are also becoming a problem. One important source of conflict in southern India is that of tourism, where people come into will come into contact with non-human species, even within protected areas, with some implications which I'll talk about. The macaques are also interesting because they have a natural propensity to gravitate towards human habitations. When I began my macaque work in the GKVK campus of Bangalore, the two troops that I studied initially were completely, what I would say would be wild troops. They didn't interact with people at all. In the course of the 3 years that I was there, both came to live in the hostels, feed exclusively from the garbage dump. So there is a natural tendency for them to come out, and that of course is because they are extremely well, they can adapt very well to human situations, and I'll again come to that. So if you look at the impacts that people have, the first, and this now I'm looking at it from the point of view of the other species, the first order impacts are those of road kills, trapping for the pet trade, other forms of interference which I talked about, hunting, killing for food or sport, etc. What we don't realize is there could be second-order impacts of human provisioning, that when people feed macaques, what happens to their lives? And this is something that very few groups have tried to look at, and we've done some studies on this which I wanted to talk about. Does this kind of provisioning actually affect their social relationships? And does it affect their reproduction? Does it affect ultimately survival? Which is a very important question. Now, now I will focus for a while on the bonnet monkeys and some of our work, and then I will come back to the general problem of whether we have some ways out to try and control this problem. Now, troops of completely wild bonnet macaques are very rarely observed anywhere in southern India now. Most troops, even within protected areas, line roads where people go because people tend to feed them and they quickly recognize this important source of food. But while we see an apparently successful coexistence of bonnet macaques with local people in a variety of non-forest habitats, for example, every city in South India has its population of bonnet macaques, the question is that we have now been noticing that the intensification of agriculture in rural areas and the increasing intolerance towards the species, particularly in urban localities, is possibly leading to a very quiet but steady decline of many of these populations. This is an extremely important problem, Because these are pest species, these are weed species, nobody cares about them. Everyone's bothered about the truly endangered, exotic species. Perhaps in a few years we will lose these common species as well, and I think it is time that we pay attention to them. So as you will see that in my talk, I'm not only going to talk about the problem of conflict, but it's also a problem of conservation. It's also a problem of the existence of these other species when they come in contact and conflict with us. Now, the Bandipur project is a project that we began in 2000, and it's meant to be a 25-year project. We've covered about 15 years of this project. And two of the important questions that we are asking there are, what are the changes in bonnet macaque society and behavior brought about by interactions with humans, which may be mediating their population declines, if at all there are? And secondly, are human macaque interactions affecting bonnet macaque populations even within our forests, which are protected for their wildlife? Now, in 1998 or 1999, Sunita Ram, a student from Pondicherry University, came to do her master's dissertation with me, and she did a very interesting study. She actually studied a troop of bonnet macaques in Mudumalai Wildlife Sanctuary, which during the mornings and afternoons would feed on natural resources, but in the evenings when the tourists came down from Ooty, would shift their foraging sites to where the tourists were and feed exclusively on food provided by the tourists. And this is just some of the data which shows that if you look at different kinds of aggressive interactions amongst the females of this troop, it significantly went up over the day from what they showed when they were feeding on natural resources, showed by the empty bars, to those of the closed bars, which is when they were fed by people. So all kinds of aggression significantly went up. Now, this is of course a quantitative increase in aggressive levels, but what we were fascinated to see is there were also qualitative differences in the nature of the social relationship, which changed within the day as they moved from one kind of foraging regime to another. So for example, dominant females displayed very severe contact aggression, sometimes drawing blood, especially towards high-ranking subordinate individuals, which they never would do when they fed on natural resources. Subordinate individuals, and the bonnet macaques have a very strict dominance hierarchy. Subordinate individuals virtually never show aggression towards dominant individuals unless they are fed by people. When subordinate females started directing not contact, but non-contact aggression towards dominant individuals. And there were many, many subtle decisions that they seemed to take. So for example, subordinate females, we found, changed their grooming preferences and started grooming or showing affiliative interactions towards those individuals who showed more aggression towards them. So clearly, there were strategies that they had to try and bring down the stress levels within the group, especially when people interacted with them, right? However, over the 15 years in Bandipur and perhaps even earlier, what we find is that even if you go beyond trying to understand what is happening within a group, you find that there are more profound influences that people's feeding of these monkeys may have. So here is a model that we started working with. It's a theoretical model. We tried to hypothesize what is happening, primarily because in Bandipur, over the last 20 years, there's a new form of social organization that we see in this population of macaques. Typically, these macaques live in multi-male, multi-female groups, but over these last 15, 20 years, we are seeing a unique unimale social organization where there's one adult male with several adult females with them. And what we've speculated is that in the dry season, the natural food becomes sparse and patchy, but food from the tourists, which is also rich but clumped, there's one loaf of bread here and one bunch of bananas there, leads to intense competition between females within the troops. This is what Sunita Ram had already seen well before we formulated this model. What we then suggested could be happening is that when aggression goes up within the group, females may decide to split, because this is a species where females live all their life together. The males come and they go. When you have then a small group of females, it may be possible for one male to guard these females, and therefore you could have a shift from a multi-male, multi-female organization to a unimale organization. That is the model that we suggested. And then over time, we collected data. Moyuk Chatterjee was a PhD student in NIAS who spent 3 years collecting a lot of data to try and see whether this model can be substantiated empirically. And
So what he found, very similar to what Sunita had found, was whether you looked at unimale tubes or whether you looked at multimale tubes, in the dry season, there was a significant increase in aggression, just as I had shown earlier, of all kinds. So clearly, during the dry season, and when people are feeding them, there is tremendous aggression and a rise of social tensions within the group. But the question then is this really leading to small groups of females? And what we found, and again, I have looked at, there are 10 events of troop fission, where a group actually split into two groups that we found over these 15 years. And troop fission affected 7 of the 30 troops that we observed between 2000 and 2011. 2 to 4 females, constituting approximately 25 to 60% of the group, left, accompanied by their dependent young and one or more adult, sub-adult males. And this is an unusually high rate of group fission among females, rarely recorded earlier in any macaque or any related species. So clearly, bonnet macaques were adapting in a way, whether it's a maladaptation or a positive adaptation is different, is a different question, to the kind of interactions they were having with people. So when people give them food, tension rises up, females leave, and when the female leaves, clearly you have now small groups which can be guarded by one male, and therefore this may lead to a unimale social organization. Now what we also, I wanted to draw your attention, and this is an academic point, but I think it's fascinating, that if you now have two kinds of social organizations existing together in one particular area, how do individuals adapt to this very different kinds of social relationships that you're expected to have? And what I've done here is actually compared between the single male in a unimale group with the alpha male of a multimale group, because they're comparable. They are both extremely dominant individuals. And I've looked at several behaviors, and I'll quickly explain them as I go along. First is what is called reproductive monopolization. So how much of reproductive access to the females does the male have? And you find, of course, as you might expect in a unimale group, that the reproductive monopolization is complete. This adult male mates with all the females. However, in a multimale group, the alpha male, though he's the most dominant, does not have access to all the females. In fact, it's a very promiscuous society, and other males also get a chance to mate with the females. There is aggression regularly and intensely towards all subadult and juvenile males within the group by the single adult male in the unimale group, whereas such interactions are rare or mild, as shown by the alpha male in the multimale group. There is active herding of adult females by the single male in a unimale group, which is very rare in a multimale group. There is aggressive troop defense by the single male in a unimale group, because there is nobody else to defend the group. Whereas in a multimale group, the alpha male never participates in inter-troop interactions. It's almost like these miniature paintings where you have the Maharaja with his harem watching his army fight. It's like that the alpha male and the female sit apart, and the alpha male is able to see other males indulging in this fight, but he never has to participate, and that's a prerogative of being an alpha. But the single male in the unimale group does not have that choice. And finally, the single male in the unimale group prevents other males from joining the group. He's clearly the despot in the group, whereas most males join multimale groups where the alpha male does not prevent them from coming. What is interesting is that this complete shift of behaviors that you have from one social organization to the other is fascinating, because we don't yet understand the underlying mechanisms. Is it a genetic mechanism? Is it hormonal or physiological? Is it simply a behavioral mechanism where individuals learn behavioral profiles? Is something that we want to explore in the future. Having worked on this model, therefore, now we want to understand what are the implications of having a unimale social organization. And what we find is that, okay, so let me just summarize what we found. What we found is that human interactions between with macaques, including the simple act of feeding, which most people think, understandably, is very beneficial to the monkeys and doing them good. Of course, most people that I've interviewed in Bandipur also felt that they would have a better next birth if they fed the monkeys. And in fact, we have people who come loaded with food just to distribute to the monkeys, and sometimes to the other species such as deer, spotted deer, or elephants as well. But this can have profound effects on the behavioral ecology of the species at two organization levels, at the level of the society and at the level of the individual.
right? Bonnet macaques are therefore, and this is again a point which is fascinating, is that they're unusual in exhibiting remarkable social flexibility, a wide variety of individual behavioral strategies, all of which seem to enable them to adapt to very different habitats, including those brought about by people. Even when you have a very disruptive anthropogenic regime where people are throwing food, people are persecuting them, they are able to adapt through their social organization and behavior in ways which seem to be unique, which seem to be undiscovered earlier. However, it is a losing battle for them. What we find is that the female emigration from the unimale groups, which I talked about, leads to fragmentation, leaves the troops much more vulnerable to stochastic influences. In fact, we found that in the 62 females that we saw between 2000 and 2004 in the unimale troops, 9 of them moved out. What happens with a very small group is if even if one or two individuals leave, there are only one or two individuals which remain, and that becomes untenable. The group soon breaks up. So these are stochastic effects. The second, of course, unimale groups are much more susceptible to predation, mainly by leopards. And in the 5 clearly documented attacks where we actually saw leopards attacking macaques, 4 of them were on unimale troops. This is primarily because the unimale troops are more in the forested tracts where leopard densities are high. It's also easier to track down unimale groups for the leopard because there are less individuals looking around and giving alarm calls. So therefore they are less watchful eyes when you have a small group and the leopards seem to target them. Both of these therefore seem to take its toll. What we find is there seems to be a significant extinction of these unimale groups in forested tracts. Sometimes they just emigrate to human habitations, which increases the troop survivability. In fact, during the 10-year period from 2000 to 2010, we had 11 original unimale troops, 7 of which have disappeared or dissipated, but there were 10 multimale troops which have survived. So therefore, clearly, when we feed the monkeys, and that sets off a chain of reactions, and they break down into smaller groups, they also become much more vulnerable to both biological effects of predation as well as stochastic effects. So we are left, therefore, with 2 questions. First, and I don't have an answer to them, but I just wanted to give you a glimpse of how we are trying to understand it. Are the bonnet macaques and other similar weed macaque species on their quiet but steady road to extinction? And the second problem, are we destined to lead an inevitable but difficult life with them? Is there really a solution? Can we ever have areas where monkeys live and areas where we live? This is true not only for monkeys, it's true for elephants, it's perhaps true for leopards. In fact, I don't know whether you know, but about 90% of Maharashtra's leopards now live in their sugarcane fields and cotton fields, right? There are no leopards in the forest anymore, they are all out, and they're a remarkable successful species. In fact, a friend of mine, Vidya Athreya, who's been working for the last 20 years on human-leopard conflict, believes that the dog and cat, the domestic dog and domestic cat population in villages in Maharashtra is enough to sustain the entire leopard population that lives there. So clearly, they are a very adaptable species, and therefore, whether it's now we have evidence of the tiger, which we think is perhaps the most sensitive to these anthropogenic factors, we see cases where tigers migrate across long distances, skirting cities and towns and villages, and they're not under pressure to do so. They do it voluntarily. So perhaps what we are also recognizing with time is that species, most non-human species, are not as delicate as we thought them to be. They're remarkably adaptable, they can adapt to human situations, they might actually prefer to live in human situations, and therefore we are perhaps never going to find a situation where we will not live with them anymore. And that raises a whole range of important questions. Now, the onset of conflict between any species, let's say macaques, or between people, first problem is it cannot be easily predicted by the numbers or types of individuals that you see. Second, conflict is often related to levels of human tolerance, which is dynamic and can only be determined by efficient monitoring. We have to deal with these situations on a case-by-case basis. Third, control of conflict necessitates the use of both preventive and reactive management methods. And I will briefly, in one slide each, talk about both sets of methods. What do you mean by preventive management? Of course, you can hire sticks. But one possibility is, can we control the population through surgical sterilization, oral contraception, endocrine regulation, or immunocontraception? The Uttarakhand Forest Department, the Himachal Forest, Pradesh Forest Department are experimenting with this. There are some inherent problems, of course, logistic, financial. Biologically, a problem is that because these macaques represent a promiscuous society where every individual can potentially mate with every other individual, unless you sterilize the females, you will not have control. Because even if there is one non-sterilized male, he can potentially fertilize all the females in that area. So that is, therefore, raises the cost, raises the complexity, because steril-